The film you are about to see shows the history, tradition, and procedure of the Legislative Assembly of Manitoba. In October 1869, a provisional government was set up in Manitoba with John Bruce as president and Louis Riel as secretary. On March 15, 1871, the first Legislative Assembly met, less than a year after Manitoba entered Confederation. The meeting took place in a house situated near the corner of Main and Bannatyne. On March 13, 1884, the fifth Legislative Assembly occupied the first Legislative Building. It was built on the same grounds as the present one. On May 21st, 1914, the first brick of the present building was laid. The province was expanding and the old building was inadequate. With the First Great War causing delays, the building took 6 years to complete at a cost of over $9 million. On July 15th, 1920, the building was opened on the 50th anniversary of Manitoba's entry into Confederation. The booming of a 15-gun salute heralds the arrival of His Honor, the Lieutenant Governor, to open the Legislative Assembly. His Honor, with his lady and aide-de-camp, enter the building where he receives a royal salute from a guard of honor. Escort and members of the cabinet precede the Lieutenant Governor from his chamber, but stop, allowing His Honor to pass between their ranks. His Honor enters the house and proceeds to the throne, along with the official escort party. There's always a full house on opening day. The balcony is full, and special guests are seated around the main floor of the house. The Lieutenant Governor's box is well attended. And the Speaker's box, too. When His Honor is seated, the Provincial Secretary steps forward and says, "I am commanded by His Honor, the Lieutenant Governor, to state that he does not see fit to declare the cause of the summoning of the present legislature of this province until a Speaker of the House shall be chosen according to the law." His Honor leaves the House so that a Speaker may be elected. The clerk points out the nominator, and the election of a Speaker hurriedly takes place. The newly elected Speaker is then escorted from his seat by his nominator and seconder, but not without a struggle. He protests that he is not worthy of the position. This ritual dates back many years in history to a time when the life expectancy of a speaker in the British Parliament was very short. It was difficult to persuade anyone to take the job then. He had to be literally dragged into the position. After the Lieutenant Governor returns to his place, the Speaker steps forward to state that although he is little able to fulfill the duties assigned to him, he has been elected Speaker of the House. The civil aide of the Lieutenant Governor steps forward and presents the speech from the throne to His Honor. The speech from the throne, read by the Lieutenant Governor, contains the proposed legislation to be introduced by the government party at this session of the legislature. When he has finished reading the speech from the throne, His Honor returns it to his civil aide and leaves the house, accompanied by the Premier and his civil and military aides. You will know that a session is in progress if you see a flag flying above the entrances of the Legislative Building. You are welcome to sit in the balcony of the House anytime during a session. At night, a light flashes on the four sides of the House. Before the session begins, the Speaker, dressed in his robes of office, prepares to proceed to the House. He is accompanied by the Sergeant at Arms carrying the mace, which is the symbol of the Crown. If you happen to arrive before the session starts, you'll be in time to witness the traditional parade of the Speaker, led by the Sergeant at Arms, followed by the Speaker and the Clerk of the House. It's the Speaker's duty to preserve order and decorum, and to enforce the rules of the House and to decide all questions of order. He cannot take part in any debates and can only vote if the House is evenly divided. Then he must cast the deciding vote. The Sergeant at Arms is responsible for the safekeeping of the mace, the furniture and fittings of the House, and for the conduct of the messengers and attendants. The Clerk of the House keeps the records and documents of each session. He must prepare and have printed the votes and proceedings and the orders of the day, and see that a copy of each is delivered to the Lieutenant Governor, the Speaker, and the desk of each member. The members of the House remain standing until after the daily prayer by the Speaker, who then seats the members by bowing to each side, and the session is ready to begin. Members of the government party are seated on one side of the House. The opposition members on the other side. Members of the Legislative Council sit in the front row of the government side. Each member of the council holds one or more portfolios. The Premier is president of the council. Although the Assembly only sits for about 6 weeks to 2 months a year, the position of minister is a full-time job. He must carry on directing his department and meet regularly in council to make decisions on the day-to-day business of the province. Any proposed change in the laws of the province is introduced in the legislature as a bill and must pass through three readings before it can take its place in the provincial statute books. At the first reading, the bill is simply introduced by a member. He reads a copy of the motion after receiving the consent of the House that it should be read. There is no debate. The motion is taken to the Speaker by a page and then to the clerk, who sees that it is printed in the orders of the day. The printed bill is then distributed to the members so that they may have the opportunity to study it before it comes up for second reading. When the second reading of the bill appears in the orders of the day, the Speaker asks if the members wish the bill to be read for the second time. It may be accepted, postponed, or disposed of entirely. If the second reading is accepted, debate on the principle of the bill starts. It may be accepted or defeated when the vote is taken. This may result in a division, at which time the bells ring throughout the building, to allow members absent from the House to return and vote. When the bells stop ringing, no member is allowed to enter or leave the House until the result of the voting is announced. Each member, as he enters the House, must make obeisance to the throne before proceeding to his seat. When a division occurs, a standing recorded vote is taken. Members stand in small groups until their names are recorded by the Clerk of the House. If the voting is in favor of the bill, it is turned over to the select standing committee concerned. After considering the bill clause by clause, the committee may accept it as it is, make amendments, or vote against reporting it back to the House. If the bill passes the select standing committee, back it goes to the House, together with any changes or amendments, for the third and final reading. For further study, the House now sits in committee of the whole. While meeting in committee, the Speaker leaves his place and is not officially present in the House. At the same time, the mace is removed from its place on the table, and the Deputy Speaker takes over as chairman of the Committee of the Whole. The bill... After acceptance by the Committee of the Whole, the Speaker returns and receives the report of the Chairman. The Speaker then asks for the adoption of the bill. This is the third and final reading. After the bill receives royal assent, the Clerk of the House signs a copy of it. The bill now becomes an act and is entered in the statutes of the province. There is a microphone in front of each member of the House. Each mic is controlled by the operator at the control board and is switched on when a member rises to speak. The units on the desk act as speakers as well as microphones. All proceedings in the House are recorded, and the recordings are stored for future use. Sitting in on all sessions are newspaper and radio reporters. They occupy a special press gallery in the House. Each evening you may hear broadcasts by local and national news commentators reporting the day's proceedings in the legislature. Winnipeg newspapers, as well as reporting the daily sessions, print a special editorial column each day. One member of the weekly newspaper fraternity is assigned to cover the sessions. His report is distributed to all weeklies in the province. Dominion-wide coverage is sent out by one of the national press services via teletype. When the business of the House is completed, the Premier leaves the House and returns with the Lieutenant Governor, who must give royal assent to the bills and officially prorogue the session. Once His Honor is seated on the throne, the Speaker requests royal assent to the bills passed by the Assembly. The Clerk of the House then reads the titles of the bills for royal assent. He then announces, "In Her Majesty's name, His Honor the Lieutenant Governor doth assent to these bills." Money bills to be given royal assent are read by the Speaker, and the Clerk announces their acceptance. His Honor the Lieutenant Governor reads a short speech commending the members for their devotion to duty. He thanks them for providing the necessary money to carry on the public business, and finally relieves them of their duties by declaring the session prorogued. The Provincial Secretary addresses the House. "It is the will and pleasure of His Honor the Lieutenant Governor that this Legislative Assembly be prorogued until it shall please His Honor to summon the same for the dispatch of business, and the Legislative Assembly is accordingly prorogued."